Okay, I'm going to show you how to set up your workspace in Illustrator for the vector drawing image reference project. So you will be, again, choosing an image that you want to reference for this process. It's so much easier to work on top of an image that already exists. It can be whatever you want, whatever you think would be interesting. Make sure you have that image downloaded onto your HP laptop, and then you will be starting out in Illustrator. So since you have an image that you're starting from, you're going to go ahead and click open, and we're going to open that image file. This is the one I was working from. Okay, and here we are. So if you want to follow along this video with me as I set up this workspace, you totally can. I'm going to demonstrate some tools in the second half of the video, so it doesn't really make sense for you to follow along at that point. Still good information for you to have, but this first part, you will have to set it up the same way that I'm setting mine up. So I'm going to go ahead and click the zoom tool, which is the letter Z, and I'm going to zoom out by holding the Alt button and clicking. I'm going to switch back to my select tool using the letter V, and then I would like my canvas size to be the same as my image here. So I'm going to go over to my artboard tool, which is here, and I'm going to drag those corners so that they're the same as my image. Now, if you, for some reason, are like changing up the background of your image, you don't necessarily have to crop your artboard to the same size. Like if you're not planning on tracing the background and you're planning on doing something else cool for the background, you can make your canvas size whatever you need. For me, it's going to be exactly the image. You can just click out of it and go back to the select button using V. Okay, so I am working on top of this image. This is where my artboard is, but I want basically two images set up here. So I'm going to click this, and my Control C, Control V, copy paste, and I'm going to drag it right next to the image, and I want them to be lined up in the center there so that it's easy to scroll back and forth and tell different areas. So this image here is not in my artboard, meaning when I export my finished project and I click only export what's inside the artboard, this is not going to be included. So this is still in my workspace so I can see it, but it's not in my actual project. So it's nice to have that kind of separate. And if you notice here, it's all collecting in my layer one right now. So this is all the same layer. Now, this image on the right is what I'm going to reference for colors, and it's good to just have that there. This image on the left, I'm actually going to work on top of, and I find it a lot easier to do that if it's a little bit transparent. So in case you didn't know, when you have an image or an object selected, over here there's going to be this little blue rectangle, and that tells you what is currently selected. So if I'm looking at both of these images, you can see that rectangle switching. I want to select this one, so I'm going to come over here and then make sure that this is the correct one selected. You're going to click properties, and you're going to turn that opacity down. And this is a matter of preference. I like it turned down. I think it's easier to work on top of. Somewhere around 50% is fine. Okay, so now I have kind of a see-through image on my canvas here, and then I have the same full-color image on the right. That helps me. So that's pretty much it for my setup layer, so I'm going to go ahead and name that so I know what it is. Now when I start tracing, I'm going to add a new layer, and depending on what part I'm tracing, I can title it whatever, right? So I'm going to start with the face, so I will just title it face. Make sure that's selected. I'm going to go ahead and zoom in with the Z key. Okay, make sure my face layer is selected here. And then at this point, you can use whatever tools make sense for you. Depending on how much or how little you're planning on simplifying things, you might want to use the pen tool to trace. You might want to use shape tools to create different things. I'm going to use the pen tool. And I'm also going to use my tablet over here, because I find that a little easier. So I'm just going to go around the contours of the face here. Now, it's currently filling with a color, and that's because over here the fill color is like white. I don't really want it to have a fill color yet because it kind of gets in the way of me being able to see the image I'm trying to trace. So I'm going to go ahead and click that red X there so it doesn't have a fill color, and that way I can continue on. Remember, if you need to edit anything after you've already traced it, you can go to the curvature tool and you can edit those specific points. So I actually don't want this point. So if I click on it and then click the backspace button, I can get rid of that. All right, so that's the basic shape of my face. Right now it does not have a fill. I want the fill to be the same color as my skin, so I'm gonna make sure that this is selected. I'm gonna make sure this fill box is on top, and then I'm gonna click letter I for my eyedropper tool, and I'm gonna scroll over and pick some area of my face that I think represents like a middle skin tone color, and I can have a shadow and a highlight later. So there we go. Started filling it with my skin tone. Now, I'm going to do a shadow. So within my face layer here, I want my shadow to be there as well. But right now, my base face color is in the way, so I'm going to make that invisible for a second here. And then I'm just going to trace this little shadow on the side of my face using the same method I did before. Okay. And then I want that color to be some kind of shadow over here. So pick one of those. All right, so now I'm gonna make that face visible again. And you've got, you know, you're starting to work up here. I'm gonna show you guys a tool to make shapes have softer edges to them. This can be good, especially for shadows and highlights, things that you don't wanna have this super hard edge. Again, it depends on the style you're going for. So this is a tool called the feathering tool. I'm gonna select this shape, and I'm going to go over here to the appearance tab, and then I'm going to click effects, FX, get it? Okay, so now I'm going to click stylize up here, and I'm going to click feather. It helps to move this over here so I can see what it's doing. So you see it's already blurring the edges, and depending on what you set the radius to, it will blur more or less. So this is a nice way to get some soft edges on your shapes for shadows and highlights and all that good stuff. So if you're interested in that, you can use the feathering tool. Okay, now I'm going to show you how to use the gradient tool. This is what I did when I made my actual project for the background because I wanted to simplify it. I didn't want to trace the cabinets exactly, but I still wanted those colors there. So let me add a new layer for my background. Remember, it's really, really, really important that you keep all your layers organized throughout this project. It's going to get very complicated. Okay, so I'm dragging that up here. Background. I just want it to be this solid block, so I'm gonna go to my shape tool and just make like a rectangle. Okay, and now for my fill, I want it to be a gradient, so I'm gonna click that. That automatically pops out this little gradient tab over here. I'm gonna scroll a little bit so I can see my colors. Basically, you have a left to right gradient, which is your type selected here, and you've got two colors. I want three colors, so see how that little plus button shows up on my arrow? I'm gonna click and add a third color. There we go. And then if I double click the little circle, I can select my color. And I'm gonna select it using my eyedropper tool because that's how I can get it from my image. Now, if you had swatches set up, remember you know how to make swatch folders and stuff, so if you have some of your images saved into swatches, you can select those when you're here as well. They would show up here, but I just want my eyedropper tool. So now I've selected my three colors. Scroll over here so you can see. This bar that's showing up here is the same as this bar here, so it doesn't matter which one you edit, it will edit both. But you can make your gradient closer to one side versus the other. Just depends on preference. Find somewhere, whatever you like in the middle. Okay, so the gradient tool is also helpful for smaller highlights, things like eyeballs or jewelry that might have like really bright little round highlights on them. So let me make my background invisible real quick. And I'm gonna zoom in on my ring. And I'm just gonna create a little circle. Okay, so I still want it to be a gradient, but obviously I want different colors, so I can open up that gradient tab over here again. This time I want it to be a circular gradient, and I'm going to zoom in even more so you can see what I'm working with. And now I don't want three colors, so I can select that color and select the trash can. Don't need three colors, I just need two. This color is going to be kind of like orangish red, doesn't matter. And then this color is gonna be like a highlight, right? So I want it to be nice and bright. And now I have a round highlight. And again, I can make that smaller or bigger. So if I want that really bright little circle there, that can be nice. If you go over here and click your gradient tool, that turns your mouse into a gradient tool and gives you a few more options. So this will allow me to actually change the direction of that highlight. So if I want it to be up on this side of the sphere, I can do that. Depending on where the sun's coming from, that might make sense. And then again, this slider is the same tool as here. So that is the gradient tool. Very helpful. So now I'm going to trace my sweater. I'll do that pretty quick here. Again, if I don't want it to have a fill, I can click that red line. All right, and I want to fill that with the same color blue over here. So again, eyedropper tool, letter I. Fill that. Okay, so my sweater is not a solid color. Over here, you can tell it definitely has a ton of little details. You can render those details in a lot of different ways. If you wanted to take a brush tool and create a bunch of little specks, you could do that. If you wanted to create more shadows and stuff, you could do that. Sometimes when it comes to vector design, it's best to simplify things into patterns and maybe grids and lines and shapes and stuff like that. So I'm going to actually overlay a pattern on top of this sweater. So in order to do that, I'm going to copy paste this shape here. So now I have two, and I can lay them over exactly on each other, that's fine. But the one on top, I'm going to fill, instead of having a solid color here, I'm actually going to fill it with a pattern. So you can do that by clicking your swatch tab over here, because patterns are swatches, and you'll have to add them, right? So I'm going to click here, open up my swatch libraries. This is stuff that's automatically loaded into Illustrator that you have access to. And I'm going to click patterns. You can open lots of different swatches, textures like wood texture, earth texture, stone texture, stuff like that. I'm just opening patterns, basic, graphic. I just kind of want like a grid, lines. Obviously, these are super tiny, so if you'd like to see them larger, you can click large thumbnail view. It's not better, but it's okay. And then I can pick one of these like vertical line patterns, and it overlays on top of my color. Let's say you want a more specific texture, and you pick something from here, but it's just not going the correct way. These are currently horizontal lines, and I want them to be vertical to match my sweater. So what you can do is when it's loaded into your swatch panel here, you can double-click it, and you can edit it. And this is going to pull up the pattern editing window. This is currently the pattern that you're working from. And you can transform it the same way you transform any shape. So like as long as you have your select tool on, I can select the stuff that makes up this pattern. Let me zoom in so you can see what's happening. So these are the lines that are currently making up the pattern. I have selected them. I could increase their stroke if I wanted to make them thicker. I could change the type of stroke they have if I wanted to. I can change their size. I can change their color, all that kind of stuff. What I want to do actually is rotate it. So I've got it selected, so I'm going to rotate it vertical. And then just click done. So now, same pattern is overlaid on top of my sweater, but now it's vertical. So that is a great way to get some more texture in your artwork that could be interesting. That's the pattern tool. You can use that for whatever. And the last thing I want to show you is changing up your stroke. So I just kind of showed you barely there. So I'm going to add a new layer here for my hair. And I did a lot of my hair texture for my actual project with the brush tool, which is great. So I'm going to zoom in here so I can see. Go to my brush tool. Now, the brush tool is kind of weird in Illustrator. So you actually have to have a brush selected first, which is up here. And basic is technically not a brush. And for some reason, no brushes are showing up right now, which is super strange. It wasn't like that the first time I tried this, but you know, we just roll with it. So I would like to add a calligraphic brush, which basically just means it's a solid stroke, but I can edit if I want to. So like if you want it to be angled in a certain way, you can do that. Right, like calligraphy brushes, if you think they have like thick and thin ends, so you can do something like that. I just want this to be, you know, your run-of-the-mill circle brush. So that's all I'm doing. And that's added here. So I make sure that's selected, and then I can start using my brush tool. Remember, you can use your bracket keys to make that brush size smaller or bigger. And right now I've got this pattern selected as my fill. I definitely don't want that for my brush tool. Oh, wait. A brush is a stroke, not a fill. That can be a little confusing at the beginning here. So what I've just done is I've created a fill color. That's not going to help me because a brush is a stroke. So I actually don't want it to have a fill color, and I would like my stroke to be that brown color that I just selected. So try and keep that straight. A little confusing, but we'll be okay. So a brush has a stroke color. Now I can trace some lines here. Great for hair textures. Okay, so now what's cool, you've got a pretty standard brush tool here. It's just kind of like these round oval lines. I can change those into different strokes now if I want to. Locking layers is also helpful. So if I just don't want to select anything else, I just want to select my hair layer. So I'm going to lock everything else. Okay, now all you have to do is change that brush back to basic. It just kind of renders it back as a stroke, which is a little confusing, but what we're dealing with. So back to basic, and then you can up that stroke weight, make it thicker, and then you can change like the edges of it. So if you want them to have kind of like pointy edges, that could be fun. Some of these are cool. Got some like wonky edges there. If you want one side bigger than another, I think that can be fun to stylize things in that way. So that is the brush tool, stroke tool. And that's all I'm showing you for today. There are so many tools on Illustrator. Honestly, the best thing you can do is type questions into Google. You can always ask me. Of course, I can try and help. But a lot of times when you guys ask me questions, I just Google things. So honestly, that's where I get a lot of my information. And that's where you should get a lot of your information for Adobe Suite. So if you're ever just like, how do I make a pattern on a shirt? Google it and type in, how do I make a pattern, Adobe Illustrator, and it'll show you what different tools can do. Remember, as you are doing this, you should be documenting your tools on that tool worksheet. So if you are online, make sure you have that printed out. If you're in person, make sure you have it in front of you. Every time you use a new tool, such as the pattern tool, the gradient tool, the feathering tool, write it down. Tell me where you used it. Tell me what it did, and that will help kind of understand what all these tools do, maybe lock them into your memory a little bit more, and also show me how much variety you're getting out of Illustrator. So that should be all you need to know to at least get started on your image reference project. Good luck, and hope it's fun for you.